the order. Do we have a member of the audience wishing to give the invocation? Saying none, please stand and drive.
Let's pray.
Father, we come to you tonight to do the business of the town. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity of being able to lead this town and hopefully put it in the right direction to continue to make improvements. We ask for your wisdom. God bless the town of Quartzsite. God bless the United States of America.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This evening, we have District 2 Supervisor Goose Minor with us. Thank you for attending. Would you like to please call the roll?
Mayor Simpson.
Here.
Vice Mayor Warner.
Here.
Councilmember Swart.
Present.
Councilmember Shu.
Here.
Councilmember Bearcat.
Present.
Councilmember Kincaid. Councilmember Goldberg.
Here.
Item 1, call to the public, announcements and communication from citizens.
Jared Mummy.
My name is Dan Heaton, town resident. Hello to the council. Evidently, I'm going to have to speak on this issue because, according to the agenda, there's going to be no conversation from the public when it relates to items 4 through 9, which is the dissolving of the committees and commissions that are currently in force. Is that correct? That would be 5 through 11.
You want to talk about the appointments also, sorry.
So, is there going to be discussion on those items, or do I have to do it here right now?
It's not listed for public discussion, so you would be able to talk about them now.
All right, I just want to talk specifically about the MUAC board. MUAC is the Municipal Utilities Administrative Committee. It was formed in 1999. And the duties of that committee are: it shall be the duty of said committee to formulate, create, and recommend any lawful plan duly adopted by the governing body for the present and future growth of the town of Quartzsite pertaining to the use of utilities and equipment for any purpose. That was Resolution 99-14, like I said, in 1999. According to the agenda, that board is up for dissolve, whatever that means. I think they're going to dissolve it, I guess, strike it out of existence. So my question is, who is going to formulate, create, and recommend a lawful plan? Who's going to take the duties that they were related, that were positioned for the MUAC, what entity is going to take those into their charge? And are they going to be accountable to the public, like the MUAC was? Aspect of the MUAC was it was accountable to the public. It was a public meeting. People could come in and voice their opinions and their problems. I don't see how that's going to occur if, in fact, the council decides to dissolve the MUAC.
We'll be able to respond appropriately at the correct time as that agenda item is brought up.
Carrie Yemen.
Carrie Yemen, Town of Quartzsite. I'm sorry I didn't know Mr. Heaton was speaking on the MUAC. That was my speech tonight, but I'm going to give it anyway because I think it's important. I'd like to speak about the importance of the MUAC board. First of importance is the process of getting five local residents to be working members. This is how the public, the residents of town, get involved in issues that affect all of us, utilities. Town government can't govern unless they know what the people want. And the people won't know what they want unless they know what the issues are with utilities and what options they can find to address those issues. The people living in Quartzsite and faced with these issues should be the ones to decide how to solve the problems under the guidance of the town manager. The more involved people are and the more information they have means the people will be responsible for the utilities function. When a government gets resistance and complaints from the town, it is usually because the town wasn't informed or asked for input. When those town people decide how to solve their problems, they can only find fault them with themselves. Our MUAC board should formulate, create, recommend through its research and discussion how they find the town council should proceed in managing utilities in the process of resolution of the problems facing that utility. I know it's hard for government to give the time required to actually listen to people who aren't actually governing, but trying instead to live by the decisions that that government makes. In order for the MUAC board to be an advisory committee, they need to have all the information about the utilities, the functioning of, the process of, the problems of, and the options for resolution. The chair of this committee should present to town council the committee's recommendations reached through their research and discussion of the issues before them. Yes, this takes time, it takes discussion, and it takes compromise, but that's the definition of government. Government by the people becomes government for the people, by their included.
Thank you.
No.
Okay, we'll move on to presentations, proclamations, and reports. Item two, presentation and announcement of ceremony for the plaque to be given to Denise Roth from the Cemetery Department for her hard work and dedication to the High Jolly Cemetery. Pastor.
Mayor, council, audience that are here, I'm going to read the dedication on the plaque, but if I can, just real quick, I've had the privilege of working with Denise for I don't know how many years, 10 years, 7 years. She has been tireless in her dedication to the High Jolly Cemetery. Those of us that served on the cemetery board really depended on her to bring to our attention what was needed. And we made the recommendations that went to the town council and they voted on it. But I can't tell you, I don't even really know how much time Denise put in. Sorting through things, paperwork, trying to locate where people are correctly buried and that type of thing. She even discovered that there's apparently a hamster that's buried out there. So she took it over from the QIA and has done a stellar job. I just can't say enough about her and wish her the best. And thank you, Denise, from the bottom of my heart for all the hard work that you've done in improving the cemetery and its environs. I can't say enough. Let me read what's on the plaque and then we're going to have a dedication ceremony. It says here, with our deepest appreciation, we hereby honor Denise Ross in recognition of your passion, unconditional commitment, and enduring dedicated service to the Quartzsite High Jolly Cemetery. Thank you, Town of Quartzsite, March 13th, 2018. Valley Cemetery where this plaque will be mounted at the entrance coming into the cemetery, and would really appreciate those of you that could make that to be there and be a part of that. Again, Denise, thank you, I love you, I appreciate everything that you've done for us.
Thank you.
Also, to add to that, Denise, Buck Connor Days will be an annual event starting up this November, thanks to your effort. Thank you much.
And she was the one that helped start the Walk with the Past and did that for several years. That was a gargantuan job, getting everybody together and to rehearse and put that all together. It has brought a lot of recognition to the High Jolly Cemetery and the town of Quartzsite.
Can I say something?
Absolutely. Please do.
I couldn't have done it at all without Public Works and the Parks and Rec Department and the Cemetery Board. They were 100% behind me and the Town Council. So thank you for making it what it was and helping me out. The plaque is yours too.
Thank you. Thank you. Agenda. Do we have a motion to approve the minutes and the ledger of the council payroll payment?
Yeah, I have just a question. I think it's been answered, but check number 42925, CDBG billing number 3 for AZ coding. Just a little bit of an explanation. It probably happened before I got here, but...
Yes, actually, this goes back, it started out in 2016, it's a community development block grant, and what the town determined they wanted to do is to take care of some of the manholes in town that were, because of the corrosive nature within manholes, that they begin to deteriorate quite significantly. And so it was agreed that we were going to find the worst ones and go in and put a coating in there and take care of those so that they'll last much longer. That's been underway. You might have seen them out here a few weeks ago doing that. And this is the final payment with the exception of the 5% that we hold for any final walkthrough to make sure that everything's totally complete. So that's what that's about.
All right, thank you. Those of us that are newbies, we weren't privy to it, so.
I'll make a motion to accept the consent agenda as presented.
I have a motion and a second to accept the consent agenda as presented. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. Business item 4, fair housing resolution, discussion and possible action to adopt the fair housing resolution as part of the requirements for the community development block grant, CDBG application process.
Denise, please.
Hello, town mayor and town council members. I'm Denise Vaughn Bishop. I'm the Wake Hall consultant for CDBG, and I'm here. Again, last year we did this as part of the CDBG application process. We have to maintain a fair housing resolution every year. It does have to be published once it's signed. And then I will be running around and dropping off the, I'll be mailing out the brochures to sales agents and rental agents. And then putting out coloring books for the community center. We have little posters we're going to be putting up. And the reason we do this is it's a HUD requirement to the state that the state passes down to its units of government, and we need to keep the, we need to meet this requirement in order to be eligible for additional funding, which is what we want to do. So All I ask is that you sign the resolution, and then if you can get a copy of it to me, I'll get it mailed out, and we'll make sure it gets published. And once again, we are in full compliance.
Thank you, Denise.
You're welcome, Jim.
Any questions? Thank you. Under item five, Park and Recreation.
I think you need a motion to approve.
I make a motion that we accept the fair housing resolution.
I'll second.
I have a motion and a second to accept the fair housing resolution. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Carry. Item five, Park and Recreation Committee Member Appointment. Consider the appointment of Wayne Wilson as a member of Parks and Recreation Committee for a term to expire September 1st, 2019.
This is a partial term, as you know, that's why it's until 2019. I don't know if Mr. Wilson's here this evening, because he's very fine. If you want to visit with him, he's asked to serve in this capacity, and that we're always looking for volunteers. We've brought his name to you.
Okay, anyone have questions first before we...
All I would like to say is I know Mr. Wilson personally, and fine, upstanding man. He even tried to teach me how to fly a radio-controlled airplane. Fortunately, he also had control, so I didn't crash. But I certainly have no problem accepting him.
Mr. Wilson, would you care to come up and speak to the council? Give us a little little of your background. Tell us of some of your plans. I know of some of your love for the radio control, but yeah.
Actually, this all started out because the Quartzsite Desert Flyers have been meeting with the town and discussing improvements with the flying field. And on January 23rd, when they met with the town, the town manager, Jim Ferguson, suggested it would be in the club's best interest to have a club representative fill the vacant spot in the Park and Recreation Board. And they talked me into giving it a try. So I'll do whatever the board needs.
Okay, sounds good. Any questions?
Are you a full-time resident?
Yes.
You're around?
Yes. I sweat with the best of them.
anyone else? Okay, thank you.
I will make a motion to accept his application for Park and Recreation Committee.
Second.
And a motion to accept his application as a member of the Parks and Recreation Committee. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Welcome aboard.
Pleasure.
I can attest to his residence, and he lives next door to me.
I ask him all.
Item six, Planning and Zoning Commission Appointment. Consider the appointment of Dan Heaton as a commissioner of the Planning and Zoning Commission with a term to expire March 1st, 2021. Commission, want Mr. Heaton to address him? Mm-hmm. Have questions of him?
Yes.
Please come up, share some of your passion for the Planning and Zoning Commission appointment.
Members of the council, my name is Dan Heaton, Quartzsite resident. They asked for volunteers, so I put my name in. I think the council is pretty much aware of my resume, so to speak, because I had put my resume put forth to the council for the last three occasions of appointment for council member. I am a very vociferous advocate for good government, I think planning and zoning is a crucial area that is involved here in the town of Quartzsite. It's got to go along with Arizona state law, and it has to comply with county law. And so there's a lot of discussion that has to take place before they can advise the council, which of course is, that's their duty of the commission, to advise the council of any kind of zoning changes. Also, it takes, they are in charge of presenting a general plan. I can read here six of the items that they're responsible for in their powers and duties. One of them is to provide advice to the council and town officials related to planning and zoning. Two, recommend to the council a general plan and amendments thereto. Three, annually review progress towards implementation of the general plan and recommend to the council changes desired due to the new legislation development trends and changing economic, social, and environmental conditions. Four, initiate changes to the official zoning map or text of the zoning code to ensure conformance of consistency with the town's general plan. Five, review and make recommendations to the council regarding proposal to amend zoning districts or the provisions of the zoning code. Six, review and make recommendations to the council regarding annexation of territory into the town. Seven, perform such other duties as required of the commission to the zoning code. So there's quite a bit of their bailiwick and quite a few areas where they can be helpful to the council, I believe, in just trying to manage our zoning code as it comes forward. I feel that having gone to some of the meetings, there's a couple things that interest me. One of them is that I've been to quite a few town meetings, but I've never heard of a report from the Planning and Zoning Commission of any kind to the council. I think that that is part of what their situation would entail. So I also, as I had gone to several meetings of the Planning and Zoning Commission, I noticed that there were no attendance by any of the council members except for Star Bearcat on occasion. I think it's real important that if we could get some of the town council people to come to the meetings and to understand what goes on during those meetings, it would be beneficial to when we make our reports or to when the council or when the commission makes its report. I will say this about the chairman. The chairman is Mr. Dave Collier. He is a very accommodating chairman, so that the public is feeling very comfortable about getting up and ascertaining any of their opinions, and I have had some, and they've been very much accepted by the committee, at least in a very cordial level. So I think that the committee itself, with the chairman, I believe the vice chairman, Mr. Kuhn, is also in that same position. So as far as being accommodating to the public, so I wish them well, and if I'm not going to be on the board, well, I still am feeling very comfortable with the people that we have on the planning and zoning.
Any council member have questions of Mr.
Are you still on the MUAC board?
Until item 7. Or is it 9? I don't know. It's coming up. But yeah, to answer your question, yes, I am.
Mr. Heaton, in your one of your applications that you'd put in, you noted that you will be living in town for year-round with the possibility of leaving maybe a month. Is this still a fact?
This is a fact, yes. I will be leaving for a month and probably miss one meeting if I'm on the commission. But that is to sell my properties up north and to move out and become, I'm already a full-time resident down here, but I do travel away from the summer, or I had been, and then my intent is not to do that, and I'm going to sell my property and sell all my holdings up there, up north.
Thank you.
Anyone else have any questions?
I have a question. What was your background? What kind of work did you do? Do you have experience in construction or anything like that?
I worked for the Boeing company for 32 okay. years. And what they call a machinist. And Norm is familiar with that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you. Discussion? Do you have a motion?
I make the motion that we accept Dan Heaton's appointment to Planning and Zoning Commission.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to accept Dan Heaton's appointment to Planning and Zoning Commission. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries. Welcome aboard. Item 7, Planning and Zoning Commission reappointment. Consider the appointment of Dave Collier as Commissioner of the Planning and Zoning Commission with a term to expire March 1st, 2021.
Mayor, Council, my name is Dave Collier, and I appreciate Dan's introduction. It'd be my pleasure to serve again on the commission. I feel it's, like he does, it's a very major part of the town that has to be nurtured, and I feel like we need to keep on going with it, and we've got some pretty good ideas. The rest of people on the council, on this commission, are in favor of a lot of growth for our town. So, thank you.
Anyone have any questions?
I had the privilege of serving with Mr. Collier, and I certainly appreciate all that you do.
Thank you.
And I'm part of Neighborhood Watch. Dave stepped forward and became our leader with Neighborhood Watch and has done a good job of pulling folks together.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Thank you. And any further discussion? What's your motion?
I'll make a motion to accept the reappointment of David Collier as a commissioner on the Planning and Zoning Commission.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second to accept Dave Collier with a reappointment as Commissioner of the Planning and Zoning Commission with a term to expire March 1st, 2021. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Welcome aboard again.
Thank you.
Item 8, Municipal Library Board Dissolution. Discussion and consideration of action dissolving the Municipal Library Board.
Mayor and council members, as you know, we've talked about this before. Some of you were not on the council at the time, and we do have some members of the public that perhaps have not been involved in this, but as we've looked at a number of these advisory boards through the council, we've had several issues that have come up that we'll be talking about here over these few items. One is, specifically as it relates to the library board, we've not had a library board now for about 3 years. The friends of the library basically are the ones that have stepped in and have been very active and have been very supportive of our library, contributed significantly. We do not want to interfere with that. We believe that they take care of the needs of the library along with our staff. They've been very, very helpful, and they do not need to operate under an agenda and the guidelines of an open meeting law. They just simply want to contribute their time and might make the library a better place for our patrons, and we like that. That's what we want. We're suggesting that the prior structure of the library board obviously outlived its purpose, and at this point in time, we would recommend that it be dissolved as a part of our code, and that we continue working with the Friends of the Library.
Any questions from the council?
there's really not been a board, staff is comfortable with the way things have been running?
They have been. They get tremendous support from the Friends of the Library, so they've been very satisfied with that.
Okay, great, thank you.
Anyone else? Do we have motion and action?
Make a motion that we dissolve the Municipal Library Board, effective immediately.
Second.
Have a motion and a second to dissolve the Municipal Library Board immediately. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye, motion carries. Item 9, High Jolly Cemetery Board and Dissolution. Discussion and consideration of action dissolving the Municipal High Jolly Cemetery Board.
Mayor and council members, a little bit different situation. The cemetery board has been very active and very supportive of the cemetery. And as Denise pointed out, contributed significantly. We're not concerned about anything in that respect. In fact, what we would like to do is to, we believe, make them more productive in terms of advisory. The efforts that have been put forth by the cemetery board in the past, with the exception of setting fees, have all been advice to the administration. They've all been advice to the staff of the town. And what we would like to do is to continue with that by making them a part of an advisory to the administration. Now, council has advised me that you have the authority to dissolve, but in terms of creating the advisory to the administration, that would be my responsibility to do that. If you were to do that, then they're still, you know, subject to open meeting laws, etc. In meeting with the cemetery board, it's been quite a number of weeks ago, months and now, actually, I think, regarding this issue, they were unanimously supportive of it, with the understanding that it's going to give them more freedom to participate, even with the field trips, etc., which in the past, when they did that, they were always, you know, having to be very careful because they might see something out there in the field that they want to talk about, but it wasn't on the agenda, so they couldn't really talk about it. So we want to get past that. We want this voluntary group to have more freedom to interact with us, both from a standpoint of programs, projects, how we take care of the public's needs, how we maintain the grounds, all of those things. Virtually all of which are administrative responsibilities.
Questions?
Okay, I just kind of want to make it clear that what we're proposing is to dissolve the formality of the board and allow them to have more interaction with the administration. Not a board particularly, but is it individuals or will there be a group?
My intent is to ask for participation of all the people that are presently there to meet with me on a regular basis, but to open it up also to other members of the public who would like to be involved in the future of the cemetery and the things that we do out there presently. So that's the kind of meetings that I want to hold, rather than a formal board structure that gets a little more complicated to work with. But I will ask that all of those who currently serve to work with me in that respect.
So it would be an advisory committee type?
To the administration.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Not to the council.
Yeah. But again, I intend to open it up, so it's not gonna be a member, you know, it's not gonna be a lot of voting, it's gonna be giving us input. Now, occasionally, just as happens now, they might want to say, well, we'd like to revisit the fee structure. Well, then that has to go through an official process, and that would come through to you as council for that process. That won't change. It's just, I still have the responsibility to bring that to you to handle, so.
So how would you notify the public that these meetings are going to happen?
Well,
and where would they be held?
We'll get the word out there in terms of the meeting. My thought now is we're probably going to have a couple of town manager type meetings monthly, and that'll include different ones at times. Or there may be a meeting when I'll include some other items, but part of it will be cemetery types of issues. I'll always make it known what kinds of things I'd like to talk about, but I'm anticipating that there's going to be a lot of people coming to those meetings and want to talk about something else, and we'll be able to do that because it won't be subject to the open meeting law. So if they've got a complaint about something that they don't think something's being handled properly, and I don't have it on any kind of an agenda, that's okay. We can still talk about it.
Okay, so are these meetings, because we're looking at other issues besides just this one, going to be put in the newspaper or posted on the internet, or how are people going
to
know it's going to happen in a timely manner?
I'm going to try to get those out there through the newspaper. I'm going to try to get them out through the, I can do it on our website, because I'll try to get them set up so that they're pretty consistent. And that's my intent.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I've served on that board for a lot of years. We had talked about it, and at one time we said we wanted to keep this board for protection for us because of the open meeting laws. But if you're going to be supervising it and monitoring it, I don't have a problem. Would they still be helping set fee structures and reviewing those types of things that you would bring it to us? I mean, that's basically what's been happening.
That's exactly what we would do.
Yeah, well, we would make the recommendation, and then you would present it. You were the one that would really present it. I just don't want to see it, you know, with your time, that it get kind of shoved kind of somewhere in the background a little bit. Because a lot of work has been done. Denise has done a lot of work. And,
yes.
And the committee, you know, board has done a lot of work to upgrade the cemetery. It's something that this town can be very, very proud of. It's one of the most visited spots in the state of Arizona, and it's on the National Registry and so I would like to see it keep that prominence, so to speak, and have the town's support, especially like the walk through history and those types of things, and the Buck Connors days and things like that. I think it could be a real draw for the town, and it would help accomplish those things. I would be in favor.
Anyone else? It seems like this has been a very progressive board. I kind of hate to see it go away. Hopefully they'll have the same meetings as they regularly would, but they don't have any obligation to do that, to meet on a regular basis?
Well, they do now. When they have a quorum, they'll meet for that purpose. But my intent is to see to it that there are items out there that we can talk about. Once again, if I call a meeting and only three of them show, we can still meet. We can still talk about it. But under your current structure, you can't. You don't have a quorum, so they can't meet. So I'm really trying to make it easier for us to talk about these issues. It is not uncommon, and this is not the only one, but it is not uncommon for us as an administration to have an issue that we'd like to talk about so we can bring you something, a recommendation. But because we don't end up with a quorum, we can't even talk about it. So we don't have a recommendation to bring you except our own. So at that point in time, they're not able to do their job. And I want the people who are serious about it, who want to come, who want to give input, to ensure that that input is considered and brought forth to the council as needed.
I just want to be sure that it's clear that these will be advisory committees to the administrative committees, to the manager. And the manager is going to bring forth a recommendation. It may or may not be what any of these boards, you know, ultimately wanted, but these are not advisory to the council, they're advisory to the manager.
I remember in the past when
Cemetery Board has requested to be dark during the summer because of people going on vacation as well, and not having a quorum, not being able to meet. So this will make it easier. Those members that are here can still meet, take care of business as required.
There were problems. We had people come in and ask questions, like people here. They would come in, they would want to ask a question, and we said, well, we can't discuss that or do anything until we have it on an agenda. So in some regards, something like the Cemetery Board, I can see where that would be better to have it more as a committee than as a board that has, you know, the open meeting laws and agendas and all that stuff. Again, just make sure that it accomplishes what it needs to accomplish, and it's not kind of forgotten about.
I believe that I remember the portion that says meeting additionally as required rather than just have to be on a regular scheduled meeting. There's more requirement occasionally with that board also.
I might differentiate for you in terms of, for example, we talked about the PNC, and differentiate why we believe that this structure works for this project. PNC does get involved in a lot of policy kinds of issues, your code, okay? That makes sense for them to be advisory to the council. The ones that I'm talking about tonight really have been more interactive with staff, giving us, you know, information and advice. And so we're saying that won't change, except for the fact that we're gonna have more flexibility and opportunity to talk about things that come up in a meeting that otherwise we wouldn't have been able to talk about because they were subject to the open meeting laws. So as a staff, we see that as a more valuable asset by handling it in that phase, in that way, rather than having it advisory to the council and such.
Any more discussion?
I recommend that we open it to the public so that they can ask whatever questions.
Okay, do we need a motion on that? To open it to public?
There's no motion.
Would the advisory committee's meetings be open to the public then? Or are they?
That would be the manner in which I would hold it. Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Seeing none, bring it back to the council. Looking for a motion.
I'll go ahead and make the motion to dissolve or dissolution the High Valley Cemetery Board immediately.
Second.
We have a second.
I have a second.
We have a motion and a second to dissolve the Municipal High Valley Cemetery Board. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries. On to item 10, Municipal Utility Administrative Committee Dissolution. Discussion and consideration of action dissolving the Municipal Utility Administrative Committee.
Yes, Mayor and Council. Now, this particular committee has some other issues that are bit different. When this committee was put together in 1999, it was when the town was first being formed, and they were looking at advice that they could get from some of their citizenry in given areas, and the idea of having a group of citizens for creating and helping us grow our utility system was a good idea. It was a worthwhile thing to do. Now, things have evolved in the utility industry in many ways, and the town itself has evolved. We've now matured to the point where actually creating a new utility system is unnecessary. We have a utility system, but keeping it up, maintaining it properly, doing all those things are still important. It now it now calls for more professional review of items. And that's been true for a number of years now. This has not just happened. Since 1999, we've grown, and probably by 2006 or so, things were pretty much in place, and the town started hiring professional consultants to create certain plans. So while the MUAC might have endorsed and then sometimes suggested that the town needed to do something as related to, say, a water plan or a wastewater plan, etc., that was really done by the consultants, and it was done under the direction of the council to do that. We don't see that as changing at all. At one point in time, as the MUAC committee met, it was thought by some members of the committee that they would like to take on more responsibility related to utilities, which really was outside of the current structure, the way it's currently organized. And at that point in time, the vote was 3-1 not to do that. They did not want to do that. You will recall in our last meeting that we had regarding the MUAC that the chairman, who is now deceased, Richard Thompson, pointed out that his main interest was just being informed. He liked the organization because he could get copies of all the reports and could be informed and occasionally talk about some of the things that the town was doing as related to the water and the wastewater. But to go beyond the current structure of the MUAC, it was not his desire nor that, but at least two of the other members. Frankly, I think as it's currently structured, it does not really contribute that much to the organization. If we were to keep it, then I would suggest that it be significantly restructured in terms of its purpose. But at the same time, I have to suggest that the town can accomplish what it needs to accomplish with the professional guidance that you've been receiving over the years. And at the same time, utilizing the public forum as you have here tonight with council meetings to talk about things that we're doing in the utility area. But more importantly, if I have that opportunity, like with the others, to meet with the people who have an interest on whether it's water leases or new wells or wastewater treatment plant or refinancing them, we can just be totally open and talk about those things. And have the feedback from any of the citizens out there, a lot more than what we currently, three people would be a quorum with the MUAC. Well, I would hope we got a lot more to participate in those kinds of discussions. And then if some kind of an issue does come up that needs to be addressed in terms of a direction that the town is going or a policy change as to how we define resident, rather than RV parks or whatever the definitions are. I mean, those kinds of discussions can happen rather freely and bring those things to you. So we think that the while there was a time when the MUAC board was a big contributor for the organization, we think that that time's passed in terms of its viability, and would suggest that we take a different approach.
I don't see that the need for public meetings on utility issues has been outdated. I think our future is going to require a lot of assistance from community organizations on this. So as long as we can structure them where we can still use them and in fact expand their use through the administrative process.
And the majority of the things that we're doing today require the appropriate hearings anyway, and work sessions. Those aren't going to go away. In fact, I think we're going to see more of them by far than we have in the past. It's just that it will give us the chance to interact with the public, feel a little more freely, so that we can open up those issues and those ideas that would then come forward to the council, and the council could decide whether or not you want to have a public workshop on that. But here, once again, as council pointed out, this would be an administrative advisory. Now, I've been doing this way too long to know that if a group of citizens comes in and tells me that this is what they'd like to see and I don't bring the council, then I'm just going to have to pack my bags. I'm not that stupid, you know. The fact is, if a group of citizens come in and they have something that they really believe is important, I'm going to make sure you know about it. And I'm not going to twist it my way, because there's going to be way too many people sitting there saying, uh-uh, that's not what we said, you know. So I don't think that a feeling that I'm going to hide something from you, that really ought to go away, because it's just not going to happen. You know? I think our public is very open and very understanding of the process, to know that they have the right to come up in any meeting and talk about something that's on their minds. And if there's something of really importance to this town regarding a utility issue, then it needs to come out, and it's a way I can bring it out.
Will there be any recordings or minutes of those meetings?
I do. Yes, there will be. There will be a recording, and I'll probably do that because I don't want to always tie up a secretary's type work. But I will have a recording, and I will take notes. But the recording will always be available. It won't be necessarily transcribed in full. But I will have notes of what the key items are and the key issues that need to be dealt with.
In taking comment from Mr. Heaton saying that at some of the committee meetings or board meetings, council has not regularly attended. And I think the work study sessions that we've had where the public, that really gives the public an opportunity to speak to the subject and for the entire council to be able to hear it. So I think that idea is gives our citizens a much better forum to make sure that we're hearing what they're saying.
And these aren't going to be, again, these are going to be open. The yeah. Meetings that I have will be open, and I invite members of the council as well as other members of the public. The only rule, of course, that we have to abide by is if, in fact, there's going to be a majority of the council there, then we need to let that be known that that could occur. But that's easy to accomplish.
So this is just an administrative committee and not a board that's constricted by the open meeting laws?
It is, because it was created by a former council, and as such, under statutes, it's advisory to the council and thus must be subject to open meeting laws. If it's administrative, created by the administrator, advisory to the administrator, the town manager, then it's not subject to the open meeting laws. Doesn't mean it won't be open to the public. That's not what that means. It just means,
right.
You know, we can talk about issues that are on their mind. If they come in that day and they were upset about the low water pressure, they can talk about it. Where now, it's kind of like that's not on the agenda if we can't talk about it.
Anyone else on the council?
Yes. I think that anything that we can do to help facilitate the whole public's input, because again, there may be somebody out there that we don't know that maybe has some expertise, but they're not a member of a board, and maybe they can come in and give some information and open it up a little bit too. One of the things, just a little aside, one of the reasons that I my name in to be on the town council was I had a sense that there was more openness and more transparency than in past town councils, and with the town manager also. And I know that some people still have a hesitancy because of things that have been done in the past, that they feel that things are being hidden and kept from them. And I think that something like this would actually be better for openness, because more people could participate and you're not in an agenda, and it would give really more people an opportunity to be able to share. And again, hopefully we can try to build more trust and work together as a community in something like this rather than as an organized board. So, my opinion.
Is this just for Quartzsite residents, or would this also include Rainbow Acres?
Well, here once again, the way in which I would conduct it is to allow any member of the public that has information, ideas that are of benefit to the town of Quartzsite's utilities, that they would be able to comment. So I would restrict it for other people who want to come in, as long as they're coming in with ideas related to our utility system. You know, here once again, they're not going to be voting. They're going to be suggesting things that might make a difference. And if it's a great idea, I'd like them to be able to talk about it, you know, and share it, because it may be somebody from Rainbow Acres, it may be somebody from Parker that said, I think that they're doing this wrong, and comes down and gives us some advice. At least we hear. We don't have to accept it, but at least we know that that piece of information is out there, and we can consider it. And if it looks valuable, the rest of the people there think it's valuable, I can bring that to the council and share it with you. So I don't want to restrict it and say, no, if you're a member, if you're not a resident of Quartzsite, you can't come into my meetings. I don't want that at all. I want it to be open to the public.
Yeah, and we have so many folks that own property, own their homes or businesses in this community, but they're not full-time residents. Mm-hmm. They still want to see Quartzsite move forward.
Yes.
And I think this, something like this, gives them the opportunity to have their voice heard as well.
I agree with you, and I think that's another issue that, you know, as time has gone along, this is a way to kind of help that issue. It's true that they've always had the opportunity to come to a board meeting. I would like them to feel a little bit more comfortable about being able to come and sit down with a group and talk about it, rather than come and get their 3 minutes, you know, and you're through. And the board maybe says, sorry, that wasn't on the agenda, we're not going to talk about it. I want them to be able to come in and say, you know, back home this is the way we do it, and they may have a darn good idea for us.
The question that I have is, there's been a lot of, I want to do this, and I want to make it go this way. What kind of provisions are there so that when and if you decide that you are going to leave us, mm-hmm. that this kind of activity is still there for the next town manager? Is there a structure, pattern, you know, some kind of information that a future town manager could use to keep these things that we're implementing in place?
What I'm going to tell you again gets back to what I was saying a while ago. I have a contract with you people. The next town manager will have a contract with you folks. If the town manager doesn't perform in a manner that you feel comfortable, it's no longer a contract. All you need to do is to suggest that you would like for the town manager to continue with the practice that's been set forth. And you can suggest that in a manner that I think the town manager probably would do it. Without having to put it in code, you know.
Write it in your job description.
If it's in the contract, it doesn't have to be in the code. You've got your ability to enforce. That's how you do it.
Anyone else on the council have discussion on this item? If not, I'd like to open this up. We had some questions from Heaton and other members of the audience. I'd like to open this up for public input.
Carrie, I'm a Quartzsite resident. As you know, for the last 5 months, I've been very outspoken in my contention that the public needs to be involved in what's going on in city government. At this point in time, after 5 months of attending meetings and talking to each of you and visiting with the staff in the town offices, I wish at this point to rescind and pull back on my adamant feelings about getting rid of the airport. Over the last few weeks, just in my own giving myself counsel, I have come to realize what Mr. Ferguson said is true, and that is that the MUAC board was instigated at the time they were building a city and getting things started. And I am aware and cognizant of the fact that at this point, what we do need is professional people to be installed. I'm glad to hear him say that the meetings would be open to the public and that things would be discussed. So I just will pull back on my resistance to this. Because in 5 months I've learned, like I told you, I'm here because I don't know anything. I want to learn. I want to be involved. I get a little upset when things don't look right to me, but I feel I have learned in 5 months enough to say that I want to pull back on resistance to this and wish you well on the endeavor.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dan Heaton, Quartzsite resident, vice chairman of the MUAC. Mr. Ferguson and the mayor both can attest that I had not been against the idea of having more of the kind of thing that Mr. Ferguson wants to bring to the MUAC. I do have some reservations. I mean, you know, I'm losing sleep over the idea that you're going to dissolve. That's what's on the agenda. You're going to dissolve the board, and that's evidently true, but there is no place on the agenda where it says it's going to be reinstated as an advisory committee to the town manager or whatever. So my question is, one, is how is the town manager going to bring the discussion that's going to take place during these meetings to the council?
What I would do in response to your concerns there, let me tell you that when I first set up this agenda, I did note that we would create an administrative advisory. Our wise counsel reminded me, we can't do it that way because then you are in fact creating. You may be creating through me, but you're still creating. And that means then, once again, we're subject to open meeting laws, etc. So we've chosen the approach that we have, that you dissolve it, and I see, you know, all six pairs of eyes looking at me saying, you darn well better do what you said, Jim. I think anybody that sits in this position understands that. So the fact is, I will be setting up a schedule. I'll be getting it out there, as was asked. I haven't got that set yet because I didn't know what was going to happen tonight. But I will be setting up a schedule of meetings and getting the word out to the public that these are the things that we're going to be talking about. But once again, I'm not going to preclude. I might be there to talk about in one morning some items regarding to utilities, and somebody will come in and they want to talk about the library. Okay. Fine. They're essentially going to be town manager meetings. That's essentially what they're going to be. Open meetings with the town manager to talk about town issues.
So rather than being articulated as a library committee or a MUAC committee,
I intend to ensure that if I have some issues related to the library that need to be discussed that the current members of the library committee are in fact informed. Because that I know already is what they have an interest in. So I want to make sure that they know that those things are going to be talked about that day. That's my intent. But if somebody else comes in on another meeting and still wants to talk about the cemetery or the library, and I was there to talk about the utilities, I don't have to say, no, I'm sorry, that's not on the agenda.
I see, you're going to combine them, you know, town manager. Anyway, so how are you going to bring this information that you're assimilating through this meeting to the council? Are you going to present it here during the course of a meeting, or are you going to do it behind closed doors, or how's that happen?
No, it can't happen behind closed doors in that fashion. When I have something that's come up in any one of those meetings, I'll report it. I'll also take notes so that when we get to the section of the agenda that talks about the town manager reports, I'll be able to talk about, you know, what's taken place in those meetings.
So you're going to report to the town council?
I'll still be reporting back to the council.
During the time of a council meeting?
Correct. Okay. That's correct.
And so, just to keep this short, are these meetings going to be on a monthly basis?
My intent at this point in time is to start out with a couple of them per month.
Okay.
And then we see where it goes from there.
All right. And so that is the replacement, like for some of these committees that had to follow the Arizona revised statutes for open meeting laws, right?
That's correct.
So now, what resolution is going to be handled by the council in order to formulate this? Does that need a resolution?
No, as a matter of fact, that's when we fall back into the position of having created an advisory board to the council, and they would be subject to the open meeting laws. So it will not be done by resolution. I just simply will begin to hold those meetings and advise the public concerning what we're trying to accomplish with the town manager and give the reports. So.
Okay, so that's going to happen at this meeting?
No, sir. I am simply responding to how I'm going to go about doing it. The council will not be officially involved in creating those meetings at all.
Well, I see. So the council is only going to just dissolve the... then it's up to you to...
Yes.
Yes. To do what you're saying you're going to do.
Right. That's correct. And if I want to be here next fall, I darn well better do it.
I see.
Yes.
Well, that answers my questions. Thank you.
I just have a couple of questions. On this last point, is there something that, worst case scenario, if he chooses not to create an advisory board, is there something that we can do to get these boards? Would it take another vote to create these boards again if he chooses not to follow, which you won't?
Yeah.
But choose to not follow your word.
I appreciate that concern, and the council has just as much authority to create the board as they do to dissolve them. And if they felt their town manager was not conducting that part of the town's business appropriately, they could then reconstitute a board. And they may reconstitute a different kind of board with different duties that perhaps even better than what we currently have.
And if this question is repeating, I'm sorry. Will the meetings be consistently once a month, or will it be bi-weekly, or how do you plan on?
Well, what I said is initially I think probably I'm going to set up a couple of meetings a month.
Okay.
And see where we go from there. If that's not enough, then I would create more. If it's too many, I'll talk with the people that are coming and we may cut back. But I think 2 a month is probably sufficient. We're talking about the kind of work that currently takes place on the most part 3 to 4 times a month is all now.
Okay. Okay.
And so I think if we have a more productive time spent twice a month, that it's probably the right amount.
And will those dates be posted on the website? Can they be posted on?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can set my calendar so that it's right there. People know, town manager meeting, open to the public. I mean, that's what we'll do. It's town manager meeting, open to the public, this week, topic is going to be such and such, but come, any issues you have to bring.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Council, Dave Collier. Listen, I want to talk about the bottom line. I've sat in a lot of these committees where we didn't get a quorum to show up, okay? And so everything gets pushed off for another month or so, okay? We don't get any business done, bottom line, okay? But not only the committee people are sitting there, it's the staff is sitting here. They've worked up everything for this meeting, and they come out here and they sit here, and you're paying them. We're paying them, okay? So for a meeting, that doesn't happen. And that's the bottom line. If we can get something where we're getting production out of every meeting, every, you know, advice to the council, without having to have a quorum or a, we can't discuss it routine, it's better off for us totally. So there's a dollar sign to this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, Heaton again, Quartzsite resident. I just wondered how, who's going to be in charge of control of the meeting? In other words, these meetings now have
It'll be a town manager meeting. It'll be a town manager meeting.
And so you will have
town manager.
You need the police to be there, or you know.
I don't need the police.
All right. So you will control the aspect of the meeting. So if there's
I will conduct the meetings, but I will be, it's my meeting, town manager.
Thank you.
But it's for the public.
I would hope if we dissolve this and other meetings that we would have some kind of event announcement now and then next fall that that these meetings will be more public and people will come and be able to come and participate.
I hope we start getting more
Right now, there's a lot of feeling that if they're not a committee member, board member, that they can't participate.
That's true.
I think it'll open it up more if we can get some advertisement out there. Okay, back to the council.
Yeah, I'd like to get a periodical report of how many meetings and how they're going, how the process is. Just to kind of give us some feedback and in case we decide we need to change something.
As your town manager, I feel that these kinds of meetings are going to be such that giving you a regular report, like I say, at your council meetings would be quite important. We have that place on the agenda, and that's, I think, the appropriate place to say, you know, I had my town manager meeting this week. We talked about these items. A recommendation came here that I think we ought to put on as a future agenda item. We'll be able to do that, I think, in a free way. We're not quite there yet under our current system.
How will the public be notified of the meetings?
Well, as we talked about earlier with the others, town manager meeting will be set, like I say, I'll probably set a couple of times a month to start. And we'll get word out there through our website and Facebook, I'll be able to kind of keep it a little more current. In other words, if I think the next meeting is one that we want to talk about certain items, I'll put that out there. But they'll still have the opportunity to come in and talk anything, you know. But that might kind of stimulate some interest if I put a few things out there through Facebook. I'll still try to put something out there in terms of posting. It won't be required, but that's what I want to do. I still want people to be able to see on the bulletin board that the town manager is going to have a meeting this Thursday at 10 a.m. On town issues, and we'll open it up.
Any last discussion, questions? What's your action?
I make a motion that we solve the Municipal Utility Administration Committee.
I'll second.
A motion and a second to dissolve the Municipal Utility Administrative Committee immediately. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries.
Now, Mayor, on item 11, I would like to ask that we table this one. In each one of these, we've been able to pretty much resolve in our minds how we can handle everything, except here on the H&D. I have the chair and the vice chair both recommend to me that H&D is one that they think could become administrative advisory in nature. There's one little catch here that I definitely have not resolved yet, and so I'd like to tell you what it relates to the TAC, because the H&D serves to handle our transit authority, okay? We've got to resolve that first, and I spoke with council about that this evening. We need to make sure that that's solid and in place and separated, so that if and when you dissolve the H&D, we still have our transit authority team. Transit Advisory Committee taken care of. So I would ask that we table that one.
Okay.
Is that something that we can put with as part of planning and zoning?
We have a number of options that we thought about. It's just that we weren't prepared for this evening. Apologize for that. But that's why I'd like to table it. And then we can talk about the options of where we can place it.
Okay. Item 11, revisited. Later date. On to item 12, weapons policy. Discussion, review, and possible direction regarding the town of Quartzsite weapons on town property policy.
We do have a request to speak on this item.
Okay. Mayor and council, on this particular item, we had this before you a number of weeks back, a few months. And our main concern as an administration isn't whether we have firearms in the building or don't. I know that there's a lot of feelings about that. My main concern as your town manager is that whatever we have on the books, we enforce. And currently, that has not been the practice. The practice has been to essentially allow. The policy says we don't allow. And I don't want my chief standing back there to have to selectively enforce a policy. I think that's a very, very bad practice. So I think we need to determine once and for all, and as a town, whether we are going to allow or to not allow weapons in our public buildings. If we are going to allow, we also feel that there could be some considerations that should be given. There may be some of you that feel under certain conditions, not individually, but collectively, that we would not allow them. For example, when the Arizona Department of Water Resources had their hearing, they did not want us to allow it. So you'll recall we disallowed it. We even had it set up so that if someone brought a weapon in, we had our screening devices set up. And that was because they conducted the meeting, okay? It was their meeting, even though it was at in town hall. Our policy, on the other hand, said, you know, you don't allow. So if they just said, well, we want to allow them, then we would have been violating our own policy. So we have to give some consideration to those kinds of things. The other is, I do know that some people would be more comfortable if people don't come in just brandishing a six-shooter on their hip, so that if some scouts come in for, you know, their civic merit badge, they sit there trembling because the guy next to them's got a six-shooter right there. So there have been those who've said, you know, if so, then we would rather that they be, you know, let's see, you know, not born in that fashion. I had an example the other day with being in a restaurant, the guy sitting next to me had a Glock on his hip, and pretty obvious. There was a little girl that was sitting, and she was just talking to her mom, was pointing at that gun, and she was kind of worried about it. She was kind of scared. You know, well, we don't want to do that. We don't want members of our public. But if we're going to allow it, I think you could set certain conditions. But the important thing is, let's establish a policy that we're willing to support and willing to enforce. So that's why it's back before.
Could you tell us what ARS, what autonomy it gives us as far as creating our own policy and how that works?
That's you.
The statutes permit the council to prohibit weapons in public buildings so long as there is an immediately accessible locker in which to store the weapons. So you do have lockers outside. I always thought you prohibited weapons and the people used the lockers, but I learned that that's not the case. So as long as you have a place for someone to store the weapons that's immediately accessible, you can prohibit weapons in public buildings.
Questions? Discussion?
I have a question. Does that just pertain to handguns? What about long guns? All guns. So really, if somebody wanted to bring a hunting rifle in, we would have to have a long locker for that.
That's right. They're made. I've seen them. So
right. I just want clarification that it was just limited to handguns, but any weapon that's
You would have to have, if you wanted to prohibit it, you would have to have a locker that accommodated that.
This past weekend, there was a rally up in Phoenix, and multiple sides to it. You had anti guns, head guns. You had people carrying ARs. You had people with carrying their drop holsters. You had between 15 and 20,000 people there. You had some DPS, not a whole lot, but they were there. And the kids, this is for the kids, and they were asking to be safe in school. They didn't believe having guns in school is safe for them. They want a different answer. However, they don't want to take people's rights away. And talking with the patriots that defend the Second Amendment, I was rather surprised that their main concern with people carrying weapons is that they're trained. And if you're gonna buy a weapon, you need to be trained, is what their response was. And it's like you buy a car, you have to get trained to drive it and get a permit. And we've got three choices here. One, you let anything and everything through, rocket launcher, whatever. And then we have the one that is basically in place now that hasn't worked because it's almost not enforceable. Then we have the third one that if you have a state issue, it doesn't say state issue, I want to say state issued concealed carry permit, which requires training in order to get that license, then I think you should be able to come into town hall concealed. And if you don't have that, we have lockers out there, and local law enforcement can ask anyone that doesn't have a permit, can ask them to remove it from the premises. Now, I favor that particular one because it makes it so there are good guys with guns that have been trained. And it isn't obvious of who has it. So when somebody comes in and they want to do harm, then they aren't going to know if somebody can shoot back at them. And we always have to remember that when you pull that trigger, you own it from the time you pull the trigger until the end of the flight of that gun, no matter who you are, whether you've got a permit or not. And so to make the people more comfortable sitting out there in the audience, and I think that concealed carry is the only way to go with the permit. They aren't that hard to get, and if you're not willing to get trained on and qualified for it, then maybe you shouldn't have it.
I see a problem with how do you make people declare if they're carrying concealed? Is it legal to make a person declare if they're carrying illegal if they, or legally if they have a permit?
If they have a permit, they are, basically the DPS has a list of everyone that has a permit. There's a thousand, over a thousand people that have permits, and that's about a fifth of the population of La Paz County. And I think it should also apply to employees. If they have a permit, they should be able to carry it on their person concealed.
My concern is with the officer at the door. If he believes someone carrying concealed, does he have the right to question them?
Yes, he does.
They have a,
I don't know.
Yes, he does. An officer has a right.
I'm just saying.
An officer has a right, and Ponce can come and speak to that if he wants. An officer has a right to ask you if you have a permit, and you and ask you to show it. They have that right. They also have a right to take that weapon, whether you have a permit or not, and have
it removed. I don't know that that's true.
Well, that's what we have learned, and Ponce can speak to that.
And quite honestly, that's fine and dandy if there is an officer at the door. I can guarantee there is an emergency in this town. That officer is going to be gone to deal with whatever the emergency is. So then who does the checking? Are we going to stand at the door and say, I think you're carrying, can I see your permit? I mean, I think there's liability for one of us to do something like that.
It says in our option here, a police officer. That means you could call a police officer and have them come, whether it's the sheriff or DPS or QPD. But right now, as it is, you have no idea how many guns are in this room right now.
Let's have the chief come up and give his input on this.
Any mayor and council, in regards to the concealed carry, yes, we do have the right to ask, but with anything, if the individual decides that they do not wish to give us that information or be forthcoming the fact that they do have a weapon, at that point there's a barrier. We would be infringing upon their civil rights if we forced them to do so. And obviously we are not going to do that because we are there to protect the citizen and their rights. So we will ask if we believe, and if that individual wishes to provide us with the information or the weapon, or if they will probably, if they're going to provide us the fact that they have a weapon, then they're going to give us their card. But they can also say, I'm not going to answer that, or nope, I don't have one, and we don't know 100% that they don't have a weapon on them or not.
Mayor, could I added number three because I knew about this one town that I am very familiar with. And it's not a recommendation, but I put it because I was asked to come up with all of the options. Number three evolved after 2 years of a very difficult debate on the town council, and this was a compromise that took a long time to get to. So it's, I don't know if it works or not. I don't know this what's happened to it, but it's, I included it only because I knew it as an option for one town. I don't think anyone else has done this. And it was a compromise after a long, long time of debate.
What I see is, I personally would be okay with that, but can we legally prohibit long guns, ARs, anything other than a handgun? A person for their personal protection doesn't need more than a handgun. In this
setting.
I think the statute does permit you to distinguish between kinds of weapons. But you would have to get the appropriate lockers for those long guns.
It's number one.
Any questions for Chief Polly's still here? Anyone?
So.
Sure. Chief Ponce, what would you like to see?
There you go.
Well, as the chief of police and chief law enforcement officer of this community, my job is to protect the public, protect each and every citizen in this community and anyone that comes through this community. I also believe in the Second Amendment, but we're not here to discuss my beliefs or my personal feelings. So as a city council, I would ask that you guys make the best decision for us as a people. And for me, having in mind is my job, I protect the schools and all those things. I believe that an individual should be trained with a firearm to be in possession of one, especially in these public buildings. You know, right now we're at a critical time in this country where there's a debate on firearms and who should have them and who should have access to them. I truly believe that people that do have firearms should go through a stringent background check to be allowed to possess them. And should they possess concealed carry permits, obviously they're going to go through a background check, they're going to go through training to obtain that. So to me, that's a plus that if they do have a concealed carry permit, they've gone through those training requirements. But again, we've seen time after time that some of those people have issues anyways. So it's not, we're not going to ultimately 100% prevent these things from happening, but we can put things in place to try to reduce them from occurring.
Could we legally post signage stating that it would be legal to possess a concealed handgun with a concealed carry permit? Something where it's posted outside, where people see that that's our policy at least. May not be 100% enforceable, but at least it's a direction.
Whatever policy you adopt, the appropriate compatible signage would be there.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering. We had a warning so that you may be subject to questioning whether you have a permit or,
not what I said.
But I mean, it was something that would at least give them pause to think about whether they want to bring it or not.
Enforcement is very difficult. If someone just refuses to tell you, as Chief Pond said, I don't know where you go after that, which is, it's just enforcement is the issue.
At least they would know something that would, there's a possibility they may at least be asked.
The statute says that the operator of a public establishment may request a person to put their firearms in the locker. I think everybody's interpretation of that is that notice that you place out there is the request. It's not somebody standing at the door every day saying, we request. So whatever your policy is, we're going to put that notice, which is the request as permitted by the statute, into a sign.
But that's requesting that you don't want handguns inside.
Whatever the policy is.
Okay, the statutes are, a qualified person must have a permit in the possession when carrying a concealed weapon and is required by any, or is requested by any law enforcement to carry the permit. The permit must be presented to any law enforcement officer upon request, along with the driver's license, military ID, state ID card, or passport. A law enforcement officer may temporarily take possession of a firearm during traffic stops and other official contacts with the public.
Then I stand corrected. Thank you.
Again, that is correct, but again, you have a citizen that may not want to comply with law enforcement, then we have an issue.
Then there's a door.
So, So we have to take that into consideration. I also want to advise council that, again, we will not always be able to be available with our sort of staffing. You know, we typically are running 1.5 people per shift, and there's times when one person's on a call and the other person's at jail in Parker. Currently, DPS only has 3 DPS officers in this area because they've all transferred out or have quit DPS to go find other jobs which pay better. La Paz County has 1 deputy within this district, and that deputy may be in Cibola, or may be in Ehrenberg, or may also be at the jail. So where does that leave us? Again, that's, if we're lucky, when we are at staffing levels, we're at 1.5 officers per shift. So.
Well, that still leaves us with a good guy with a gun for when a bad guy comes in.
God willing. You know, as I stand up here, like I said, my approach is to provide the best safety for this community. And we all have, as leaders, we all have to look at those things and make the best decision for our community.
I think we understand that you can't be here or everywhere at once. And it takes time to get from here to there when a bad situation happens. We all understand that. But if law enforcement is not available, then the individual may have to defend themselves in whatever manner is needed.
Correct. And many of our staff are, I don't believe, are gun lovers and weapons carriers, so that's something else we should take into consideration.
Well, that's their choice, and the staff should have a concealed carry permit. If they do, they should be able to carry it concealed, therefore the staff wouldn't necessarily have it. But if somebody came in and wanted to shoot up town hall, there may be, could be possibly, a staff member that has a concealed carry with a weapon that would stop it.
That's up to you as a council. If you have nothing further for me.
It's a little bit different in how you handle an employee situation because as a condition of employment, you can do some different things. It's currently not a practice to allow nor disallow, but I believe it has been a practice that they just don't carry except for. Not by, what I'm saying is, I know of no written administrative directive, okay, either way.
Well, I know in the past that there have been many employees that did carry, including our attorneys and other council members and managers, and I believe that would be an administrative choice to decide whether somebody could or could not.
And I think that that's probably what exists today is because this policy at some time in the past was approved by the governing body, and so any staff that had previously carried stopped carrying, with the exception, of course, law enforcement. But there's no actual administrative.
Not to put our county supervisor on, but could you share with us what the county's policy is?
Well, I can't quote the policy, but we do have signs posted in our building that no weapons are allowed.
That's what I thought. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Well, if there's a bad person with a gun, and somebody said that there wasn't guns allowed in the building, what would stop the bad person from bringing his gun in there, into the room? Especially if he thought everybody didn't have a gun.
Are you addressing that to my comment?
Okay. Yeah, why not?
Because I'm not law enforcement, I'm not an attorney, but I think the answer to the question is, if there's a policy in place that says there's no weapons allowed, and somebody brings one in, they violated that at that point. They can be dealt with once it's identified. Can you stop everything? No. But without that sign posted and they come in with it, then you can't make them leave because they're not violating anything. So I think that's the theory behind what the county has done, is we have the authority to remove somebody for that reason.
Obviously, if we don't know they're carrying, that's not going to happen, but if something does happen, then they can...
That's not what he said.
Like I said, it's not a perfect world, and...
By the way, this sign is going to stop anybody that, with an agenda, that's going to come in with an agenda. But I think it goes a long way. If you say, we don't allow guns, then you have a leg to stand on if you are a suspect of someone. Because my understanding of what I just heard was that if you don't have that policy in place, you can't even really approach them. I mean, you can approach them, but you can't really do anything about it. Whereas if you have a no guns allowed, you can actually remove them. Is that correct?
The gun. Yes, if they're in violation of the policy, because they would be required to put the guns in the locker.
But here again, we have enforcement problems, and staff aren't going to approach somebody with a gun and tell them to put it in the locker. So here again, we have the police that have to do that, and it has not been done for years.
Let me take it. We actually did have, I might just say, we actually did have some staff that did that only because they hadn't been here that long and they read the policy rather than knowing the practice. And they advised somebody, I'm sorry, we don't allow guns in down the hall. So, I mean, and then in fact, one of the staff members said, hey, what happened to that sign on the front door? They went and put one on there. You might recall that.
Yeah, I recall that.
They put the sign on and said, no guns allowed. Because that's what our policy said, even though that wasn't at that point in time the practice. But,
yeah. So, the bottom line is right now, we have the policy in place, we're just not enforcing it.
That's correct.
Our decision, or our task, is do we want to enforce it or not?
Well, right now we've suspended that policy.
Yeah, it is under current suspension by council action, but our position is that we either allow or we disallow as we currently state, and which would mean if you want to disallow, you simply don't change the policy, and we will start enforcing the practice, putting signs up, doing all of those things to communicate to the public that we do not allow them in the public buildings. If you wish to change that and allow it, then we need to actually change the policy itself.
And public buildings would also mean the court, correct?
Well, the courts do not allow anyway. Okay, they have their own special rules regarding the courts, and the judge has that right.
Also community center?
Community center, any of the actual public buildings, they would not be allowed. And that would include, you know, our public works area. Park. That would include the police department, with the exception of the sworn officers that are authorized.
That include the park also, and community center. Right. The park, community center, any town property.
Yes, you can also disallow them on the parks. That's correct.
I think so.
Back to what Loretta stated, if someone comes in with an agenda, a police officer will not stop someone that comes in with an agenda. They may put up a battle, but if they come in with an agenda, the only protection we would have after that officer would be if we were carrying ourselves.
I would concur with that. And I think the majority of the communities which have a no guns allowed policy aren't thinking so much as of the person who comes through that door ready to fire. What they're looking at is the fact that people in the park sometimes carry a water bottle with something other than water in it. And after a series of drinks, they're not getting along with the guy sitting next door to them, next to them, whose child is making too much noise, and those things begin to occur. And even in our own library, believe it or not, we have patrons that get upset with one another to the point where they start swearing at them and going on. And you'd be really surprised that we don't worry just about people being quiet. We worry about some of their physical safety at times. And so I think what we look at under these kinds of conditions is should we create a little bit of a safer environment so that somebody who's carrying isn't brought to that level where they don't use best judgment. I would concur with the council member that I think the majority of people carry that have gone through the appropriate training understand the responsibilities that they have. I really do believe that's true. But some of them also can't lose control. And I think our statistics show that the majority of the counties that we often see, I'll back off of that because I don't know statistically that that's the case. But a large number of the counties that we see even happen just in families where they get in a family argument. One just hit the day of peace. Brother shot another brother. Just got another argument. That's all. Killed his brother. You know. So those are things I think that communities worry about more than somebody charging through the door, you know, with an assault weapon. You know.
At one time, we had a council member attended and with concealed weapon. I don't know if the sign was on the door, if guns were not allowed. Is there a difference between the public out there and the council as far as who would be allowed to pack a weapon, if any, other than a police officer? Are we officers? What rights?
Most cities apply the rule across the board to council members and public. I know one that is considering making a distinction between council members and the public. That's, I don't know if that would be upheld or not, frankly. We're looking at it. But most cities that I'm aware of, all but one city that I'm aware of, applies the rule across the board to both council members and the public. And I can't think of a good reason why you would make the distinction.
In policy number 0209002, under exemptions, it does say the following are exempted from this policy, and it exempt our law enforcement, but then it also says persons appointed by the town manager to provide security for town facilities. I'm assuming that would be an outside firm, but could that be?
Well, technically, under that guideline, I think it was put there so that if a town manager felt that it was necessary to have support during the day, they could do that because law enforcement is not always readily available to us here. The discretion was what they were trying to do, was to give it to the town manager for that purpose.
Well, we're one of the smaller areas and probably have less law enforcement officers available to us than many of the larger cities and towns. So being more rural, I would think we would have more of a need to be able to help protect ourselves.
I'm not supporting that one of us should carry a gun. That's not what I was saying.
I'm sure if you checked with all the cities and towns, you would have a complete mixed vote on every one of them, three, four, back and forth, either way.
Yes, you will.
So I don't know that we're ever likely to get consensus on any direction on this. What would be the next appropriate?
Well, the issue before you is simply to say we want to continue with our current policy, or we wish to change our current policy and allow, or we want to allow under certain conditions. To continue to just say, well, let's just ignore it. I don't feel comfortable with that decision. As an administrator, I like clear direction from the governing body. And I know this is a tough issue. Would have been easier a few months ago, because now we're kind of under a cloud of an incident that's brought a different view, you know, nationally, and it's made it tougher. But I still think it's important. And it's one that I think that, as I agree with you, Mayor, we may not get a consensus on. I don't expect that. But as your town manager, I think your staff needs direction that we can work with.
Okay, I'd like to clarify.
I'd like to close this and open it up to public. This is an item for public. Get some input there. Do we have anyone wishing to speak on this?
Jaron Mummy.
Just for my clarification, we're focusing on more of the firearm aspect of the weapons, correct?
That's the way our policy is currently. I believe specifically, for example.
Okay, because you mentioned that you were worried about physical confrontations, thank you, between two people. I just wanted to point out, if a person doesn't have to use a gun, if he uses pepper spray in the library, it's going to affect, and he sprays a lot of it, it's going to affect most of the building. So it's not just, you guys are focusing on the gun aspect of it. In my opinion, you should be looking at guns, tasers, and pepper spray, because all of them could cause an issue within in the confrontation.
Right. I think our current policy states that lethal weapons, such as firearms or knives with a blade longer than 3 inches, but we don't address pepper spray or any of that, but those things which are considered lethal weapons, and we chose only firearms or knives with a blade longer than 3 inches.
Okay. Dan Eaton, Quartzsite resident. It seems to me like it's a pretty cut and dry situation. You're going to have to either implement a new set of rules and regulations, or you're just going to have to put the sign out there on the door that says, weapons aren't allowed in town hall. We're talking about only public buildings. So, you know, you want to have a solution. Obviously, the solution is going to be to put the sign up. Not going to be to try to rewrite the whole damn Constitution to try to figure out how to protect or not protect a certain amount of people.
Here I am, of course, a resident. I concur with Mr. Eaton. The best thing to do is put a sign on the door saying your gun is not allowed in here. If you don't want to put it in your truck and lock the door, then put it in the locker and lock it, but you cannot bring it in this building. Curtis.
Shanana Rain Golden Bear. I'd just like to clarify that ARS 133108 prohibits cities and counties from banning firearms in parks. So what you would be doing is in buildings, okay? And however, we do need to address our park rules on that. Because we need to, you can say no discharge of weapons in parks, but you can't ban it in parks.
I want to clarify, I recognize that that's the case, but that's not the case with our current guidelines.
Right.
Our current guidelines, in fact, say this weapons policy applies to all town employees, volunteers, contractors, visitors, and includes, but is not limited to, town buildings, parks, maintenance, facilities, etc. So even our current policy has some conflict with state statute. I understand that. But tonight, mainly what I need some clarification on is whether or not we are going to take the direction of disallowing, in accordance to the guidelines that I'm sure our council will straighten us out on, or allowing, you know.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Monica Timberlake, resident. I often have my child, or children, sometimes multiple, in these meetings. Right now, I feel like that's a safe place for them to be. I would like to see the town enforce the policy that we have that does not allow firearms in the building. I'm grateful for law enforcement that is typically here, and I know they do the best they can to protect us. But the more guns in this room, the greater chance something's going to happen. So I would like to see you enforce the policy you have right now.
Let Mr. Wilson come up.
Wayne Wilson, town resident. While it would be very simple to stick the tiny on the board, the town council must have had a reason to suspend the policy. You might consider why or what that reason was and how simple it would make a sentence or two to make that official policy. I don't want to see it just take the easy way out, saying we have a policy, stick a sign on the door, we're done. If you saw a reason to suspend the policy, I liked everything that Ms. Bearcat said. It would be very simple to put a simple consideration or a limit if it was going to be a concealed carry or whatever. All it takes is a sentence or two, and then I'll sign accordingly.
I just have an issue. I agree with Chief Ponce. It's going to be really hard to enforce it because we still, contrary to what one of you believe, we still do have a Fourth Amendment. And as a citizen, I still can refuse to a Fourth and a Fifth Amendment. I still can refuse to answer a question from a police officer. And personally, I don't want a town employee walking up and asking a member of the community, if they have a gun or not, just out of the wind. I would want them to have a little more evidence than just, hey, I think you have a gun. It can't be that, in my opinion.
Kim McCaskey, town resident. I just would like to say that in the essence of the school shooting in Florida, the church in Texas, probably nobody in that church had a gun on them. Thank God somebody down the street had one and came and took the guy out. But if the officers, if there's only one and a half here on duty, a shift, if there's an accident on the highway and somebody's dead, where's that cop going to be? If this building does not have somebody in it that's carrying, what's going to happen if somebody comes in and decides to pull something out on people? It's scary, and this country is not the same as it used to be. We need to think of ourselves.
Anyone else? Seeing none, we'll close the public discussion and bring it back to the council.
I believe that Shanana read the statute wrong, where the cities and towns are not prohibited from limiting or prohibiting the discharge of firearms in parks, except under certain circumstances, such as a shooting range, hunting areas, and things like that. So I just wanted to, so our policy might not conflict with that statute.
So there's some exceptions there.
My question, is there a current town policy about it being illegal to discharge a firearm within the town city limits?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So if somebody were in the park and they discharged a firearm, that would be illegal?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Under Arizona law also. That is also illegal under Arizona state law. You cannot discharge a firearm within the city limits. So that would be a criminal violation under state law.
So we're covered.
In that respect, yes. It's the carrying issue that we're concerned about. And mostly I, as your town manager, am just simply concerned that we have a policy that we want to enforce.
Whether we want to enforce the existing policy or let it, or remove it?
Tomorrow I can slap a sign on the door that says no, or we can say we don't restrict anymore. Either way.
In the interest of public safety and peace of mind, I'd like to make a motion of number three and have it say Arizona State issued, not just a permit, and have that as our policy that can be enforced by QPD when they're around. And then a sign on the door could say no deadly weapons permitted in the building unless you have a Arizona State concealed carry permit. And then they're warned, it says our policy, and then QPD can take action on anyone that is other than that. Because of the way things are going now, anyhow, that's my motion.
I see a problem with that because there is reciprocity with some states. If you have a concealed carry permit, some states will allow you that permit. Like there are 38 states that have a reciprocity where if you have something from Arizona, it's permitted in another state. And so if you limit it to an Arizona concealed carry, that's going to be a problem.
The statute says that in order to recognize a concealed carry permit, like in public buildings, that their policy has to be equal to Arizona's policy of proficiency with the weapon and background checks. So yes, you can recognize another one, but by saying Arizona, it would make it so that if someone has one, then QPD could decide whether it's recognized or not. Not just anyone with a two-hour course.
Susan may be a better person to respond to this, but my concern is that because we are limited to Arizona, the law itself states that if it's a state that has reciprocity with Arizona, then we couldn't enforce it. It would be my concern, Susan.
I don't know.
Well, then word, however, it is that you have to have a CCW that meets the Arizona standards.
We'd have to research that.
Yeah, my concern is it's not clear and concise for my staff, and I may not always be around, and they're going to have to be making a decision based on what the law reads, and it wouldn't be enough clear enough. So that's my concern, Council.
Table it.
I have a motion. Do we have a second?
I'm concerned about public safety myself, and our indecision could affect that. So in order to put something in place, I'd like to make the motion that we put our current statutes back in place until we come up with a better plan.
Well, there's a motion on the floor. I don't know if it
died without a second. So we have a motion on the floor to reinstate our current policy until we can come up with a better. I don't know how much of that needs to be added at the end. I would assume that would be automatic that until we revised it.
We can come back and talk about it as much as you want.
Yeah.
I'll second that motion.
Okay. Any further discussion? We have a motion and a second to restate that.
To put our current policy, our suspended policy back in place until we have a better plan. At least we'll have something.
What I want to know is QPD going to enforce it? They haven't been.
We will administratively enforce the policy that you established at, to the best of our ability. Understanding that there will be times because of the unavailability of an officer that may not occur.
Even when there is an officer here, they have refused to enforce it.
Sir, may I answer that?
Yes, go right ahead.
As we've been directed by my boss, we would not enforce anything at this time because of council's previous request for us not to take enforcement.
No, this was prior to when we, prior to when we stopped that.
Yes, but then...
If you want to get specific, we can.
As my present employment, per my boss, the town manager, I was directed that my staff would not take any action until further notice, and that's why we've been doing it.
That is correct, and that's because under prior council guidance, although they did not give the official action that you did, they said, we're not enforcing that. And I was not even aware for quite some period of time that there was, in fact, a specific policy. And that came about when a staff member placed that sign on the door, and I said, we don't have a policy, and they said, yes, we do. And then they brought that forward, and it was at that time, and that's, if you'll recall, this is not the first time we've talked about this issue. We've been talking about it for some period of time. And I finally got to a point where it was either tell me to not enforce it, to enforce it, or whatever. And that's where we're at tonight. So the chief is correct. He was told at that time, we're operating under the understanding that we are not enforcing that policy at present. And then we brought it to the head by bringing it to the council.
Would you please restate the current policy that we're talking about?
Oh, well, it's in your packet.
Okay.
In your packet under...
Just want to make sure that everybody understands.
Item number 12, the Town of Quartzsite Weapons on Town Property Policy. And it's property, it's policy number 0209002, which means it's been in place for 16 years.
To reinstate the current suspended policy until and to enforce it until we can come up with a better plan. Does that make sense?
You don't really need that last part.
Okay.
Because you can come back
to reinstate
and change
the
policy.
Suspended policy. Okay.
Second that.
Okay.
Without the end of.
Yeah, friendly amendment.
Yes.
Okay. Any final discussion?
I think the way this is worded and what's going on in this country, it's likely that there will be a whole bunch of new direction coming this way in this upcoming year or so. Okay, we have a motion and a second to enforce, how was the word? Enforce
to reinstate.
Reinstate the current policy. That's it.
We have a second.
Okay, all those in favor signify.
Roll call.
Mayor Simpson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Warner.
Aye.
Councilmember Hsu.
Aye.
Councilmember Bearcat.
Nay.
Councilmember Goldman.
Aye.
You didn't ask.
I didn't ask for me.
I was trying to miss Councilmember Kincaid, so. Councilmember Swart.
Aye.
Motion carries. Mayor, Council, I know it is a tough subject right now. But I really appreciate your giving us specific directions we can follow. As your town manager, I tell you that We will act promptly. I can't assure you that the signs will be on the door tomorrow, but we will put this back in place in a very timely fashion. I think, yeah, I think my staff might have the sign on before I tell them to, you know.
Okay, let's move on to communication. Report from the mayor. Coming soon, all registered voters are going to be given information, and you'll see a lot of signs around town, newspaper articles on the county's spending limit. The county has grown to a point where the spending limit needs to be increased so that the county can pay all the bills and get back some of the employees that have been laid off or terminated or riffed. That's going to be coming forward. Look for it, watch for it. It's one of these things that we need to act on so our county can get healthy again and start supporting us in a way that we expect. So that's going to be coming up. That concludes my report. Next report from council members.
I happened to be at town hall the day that our power went out. Of course, I because of whatever happened down on Main Street. And I have to tell you, between Tina, Jan, and Crystal, they acted so professionally, knew exactly what to do. I said, what can I do to help? And I guarded the door for help. We cleared the library. Cleared the building, but I just want to tell you, your staff did an incredible job that day, and we should be darn proud of them. The other thing is, I don't think at the last meeting, I didn't get an opportunity to thank Ms. Shawnee for being on the Municipal Property Corporation Board for the time that she was, and I think we should acknowledge that she did a good job.
Just want to remind people the Good Friday service is at the Alliance Church this Friday at noon.
I do have one other thing. We did the last Show Me Ride, the program that we were doing through our passport tourism program, the La Paz tourism team. We had 51 vehicles that went out on that ride. We had 100 people, 101. I think that included a dog. a lot of those folks stayed, had dinner at the QIA, attended a concert. But the interesting thing, we had people from Yuma that had never been here before, had heard about the ride from people that had been on previous rides. We had people from Phoenix, a lot of people from Phoenix. We had 6 people from San Diego that came over, and they've already called and booked RV space for next season, and are looking at a house in my neighborhood. But anyway, very successful. We're really, really pleased with the way that turned out.
This Saturday, we have an Easter egg hunt out at the park at 9 a.m., and I suggest you get there a little bit early because once those kids go, it's gone.
Okay, now the reports by the town manager.
Thank you, Mayor, Council. I've got a few items here that I listed, mostly to remind myself to take care of, but I also have a few others that I'd like to. And this one actually just came up today, and I thought it was very nice, and we needed to give some special recognition to Michelle. I want you to handle this, okay? You stayed this long, you take care of it.
Yeah. Michelle Kinnear, interim recreation department supervisor for the town of Quartzsite. I currently run the after-school program. I ran the summer program last summer, and I'm getting ready to do it again this summer. I walked into work today to two different couples waiting for me down at the community center. We got a donation of $250 from the community thrift store to provide funding for the summer program. Joe and Donna Wallingford from QMDC, the Quartzsite Metal Detecting Club, also had a donation of $1,000 for the kids' summer program. They want to see us implement more of a reading program than I did last summer, more activities with the kids, craft items, snack items, and hopefully that can help with some of our lunch that we provide the kids too. It's a free program that we provide the public kids right now to come on down there. The school bus drops them off after school. I help them with their homework. I help them with tutoring, help them understand their homework, try to do educational games with them and give them a little bit of free time and socialization. Summer program is, without the homework, geared towards the same thing. I still tutor them. I still do a reading program one day a year. Last summer, we came down here and used the library. Billy let us use the children's library one day a week. So I want to see more of a reading program implemented, and this will definitely help with providing books and places for them to read and whatnot within the community center.
Thank you for that report. And especially thank you for those donations for those two. We get these every now and then. I think these people deserve recognition for the support they're giving to the programs for our children. Quartzsite does provide a program that's not usual for towns our size to do. They're usually supported by other agencies. But we do so because we have the support of the community to make that happen. So
that won't go into the general fund, correct?
It will go towards those programs. Yeah. And then I also gave you just a couple of three items tonight to. I gave you a copy of a presentation that was given at 5:30 today on our street improvement program, our Main Street landscape project. I don't have any extra copies right now, but we can get some for others who might like to have them. I don't know exactly what happened, but I really do want to thank the public that turned out. That's Mr. Eaton. He was the only public that turned out for whatever reason. I don't know. I think we got the advertising out there, but apparently it wasn't good enough because we just didn't have the results that we had anticipated. We're going to try to get more information out there for the public as a whole.
Emmett brought that information. It's back here on the...
Oh, okay, yes.
The maps and
they're on the boards. Yes, I can't see the boards now.
So that's available right in the back there.
And if anybody has any questions regarding these two programs, just get a hold of us. We can give more explanation. Just so you know, we are going to ensure that the people whose properties are in these areas are contacted directly. Okay?
Okay.
So even though they may not have made the presentation today, they will be contacted directly and informed as to what the projects can be so they can give us input before we start. It's budget time. We receive this from the state that goes over a lot of items, some of which is not pertinent to us, but it was kind of nice for me for show and tell, and that is to say we're going to get started. I'm anticipating a workshop with council, which will certainly be open to the public as well, and I would anticipate that we're going to try to get that workshop scheduled sometime the week of the 17th of April. It'll be separate from a regular council meeting. We'll be talking to you as council members to find the right day and time and then getting the message out there to the public as well. But we do need to get started in that process.
Is that format going to be similar to the way that it was last year?
It will. The first meeting will be similar to last year where we have some presentations from the staff members on what they've been doing. Especially this year as it relates to the work program that was established by the council last year in the budget, and then the things that perhaps they did not get done that they want to continue on with, you know, carry over for the new, fiscal year, and maybe some new things as well. And then the opportunity for you to give input to the administration so we can then begin refining the budget for you. And after that, I would anticipate that we would have at least two more workshops before we were to bring you a final budget. I think it went quite well for us last year, and we all have a little bit better understanding now of how it works, but it should work smoothly. Then also, I was, let's see, one other item, I just wanted to report that you had approved us looking into refinancing of our GATA finances, our GATA excise tax obligation. And we've been doing that, and we have a phone call regarding that. More items that says, that told us that we've gotten it out to about 8 to 10 banks. We're starting to get some results back. Looks like it's going to be a valuable thing for us to do. I don't anticipate us having on the agenda for the 10th, but probably for the 24th of April. Okay. Update on wastewater treatment plant violations. I know that there's been a real concern about that. What I can say is we are not meeting the specific schedule, but we are in communication with the Arizona Department of Environmental Quality regarding the schedule that they set, so that they understand we're not ignoring them. We just simply have not been able to implement all of the improvements that they want to see at this time. So they're cognizant of that, and they're working with us in that respect. They have not taken the next step, which would be to put us under a consent order or agreement, which essentially is the process whereby they say notice was not sufficient. We now are going to set the specific dates, and if you don't comply to those dates, we reserve the right to step in and take over your plant and make the improvements ourselves, you know, and then bill you for it. So we're not going to reach that stage, because they know we're working with them, and that's the important thing. We've just continued with the communication. Then on the economic development group, just as a report, we're still making some progress, but I don't anticipate that is going to be completed either until probably the end of April. But I've found some really good information, which I think makes it more applicable for us. The accounting of revenue and costs of the town resolving the AZOP race, we did, finally get a contract in place. We provided some labor, we provided some equipment, and kept track of the hours and the amount of water, etc. And we submitted to them a bill which came to $1,158 that they owe us now. I have to tell you, I haven't seen the payment yet, but we submitted. That doesn't mean it didn't get it, I just haven't seen it. Okay. Then the item regarding the Arizona League of Cities and Towns state share revenues, did you all get a handout in your box on that? That was supposed to go in your box, and I just
it's in the council book in the front.
It is in the book? Okay. Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah, so that's just to help you understand kind of where we're at from the state's revenue sharing side. So that kind of helps us in the preliminary establishment of our budget. Okay? And at this point, that's all I have.
Okay. Having no further business to come before this council, we're hereby adjourned.
You know those two- cookies in the back of the room here were brought over by Emmett from the presentation, and they're available for the public.
Yeah, I can get one.